Dr. Licona, how can families make the most of the family meal?
Well, first of all, they can make sure that there is a family meal. Surveys show that more and more families really don't gather, don't sit down together to break bread, don't really protect the time for the family to share a meal. So the very first thing is to get that commitment made as a family. A story that I like to tell is about John and Kathy Colligan, a Catholic family, and they said they had five children. Everybody had busy schedules and out-of-home commitments, meetings, sports, games, lessons, and so on. But they decided they wanted to make a priority of the family meal and to have a commitment to try to do that every single day. So they put all their schedules on the table. And it meant that sometimes they had to have the family meal at 4:30 in the afternoon. Sometimes they didn't have it until 9:30 or 10 o'clock at night. But it was that important to them to be able to gather all together as a family for that experience. They made certain kinds of, you know, rules. They began with prayer, no complaints, no put downs, no carping, no criticisms. So they asked Jesus to be present at the table to help them focus on the good in each other. That got them off on the right foot. They turned all phones off, made sure the television was off. And then they, you know, years later, when the kids grew up and all had their own children and their own families, the parents asked them independently, what is something we did as a family that you will do with your kids? And each of their grown children answered independently the family meal. That was a treasured tradition for them. It was very meaningful. Now, in order to maximize the quality of the communication and the conversation that happens, there needs to be a deliberate effort to get everybody involved in that conversation. I recommend proposing a topic. It might be, what was the best part and the hardest part of the day? What was something that you did for something today, did something today that was nice for somebody? What was something nice for someone did for you? What's something that happened that you didn't expect? What do you feel good about from the day? What did you accomplish? My son and his family here in San Diego begin with the round of what they call gratefuls. What are you grateful for today? And that puts them in mind of their blessings, the things that they're grateful for from God. So a focused topic helps to get everyone involved. Everyone gets to be heard. I asked tonight at the dinner table, you know, what do you find valuable? They often start with also another topic. What's the good news for the day? And one of the children, a teenager, said, well, it helps you to focus on the positive part of your day. Maybe you had a bad day. And if you think of the good news, that shifts your attention to the positive, and you can enjoy the good news that other people share, and everybody gets to be heard. So making it a priority, protecting the time for it, having a focused topic of conversation.
So you're saying, Tom, there's a relation between family meals and character building at home.
Yes, and actually there's solid research to show that there are many documented benefits from the family meal and this kind of family conversation. For example, there is something that's now more than 20 years old called the Harvard Family Dinner Project. Actually, if you Google it, it's simply thefamilydinnerproject.org, thefamilydinnerproject.org. And this is a resource for parents that, first of all, offers a simple recipe for a family dinner that night, something easy to make, not too much time, not too complicated. And then it proposes conversation topics that you can use. For example, what is something that makes you feel loved? What can other people do that makes you feel loved? What are some things that you wish we did more often as a family? What are three ways you can make other people happy that don't cost anything? Dozens of conversation starters like this. In my book, How to Raise Kind Kids, I've got 40 different conversation starters like this that are jumping off points for families to have good, meaningful conversation, exchanges of thoughts and feelings. And you need to create a context for this. I encourage families to establish manners for talking as well as manners for eating, that this is a sharing of thoughts as well as a sharing of food, and that we need ways of doing that that encourage everybody to speak, everyone to feel that they're being listened to. And the Harvard Family Dinner Project actually showing that families that do this, that eat together and talk together on a regular basis, have children who have better grades in school, they have greater resilience, higher self-esteem, lower rates of anxiety and depression, less likelihood of teen pregnancy, a whole range of positive outcomes coming from this family tradition of making a big deal of the family meal.
So you would say, Tom, part of the crisis in character that we see today can be traced to the poorer family meal quality, or fewer and fewer families doing family meals together?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the identity that children have as a person, their value system, that comes out of something. It comes out of a culture. So the question is, how do you form a family culture that in turn forms good character? Well, you need to provide time for that. You need to provide traditions for it. And then you have to provide, you know, some sort of deliberate way of creating meaningful conversation. Conversation is one of the main vehicles through which we transmit values that we cherish. And good conversation doesn't just happen. It's not accidental. These days, there are lots of things that get in the way with that. People are living lives in the fast lane. They're too busy to talk to each other. Or when they are together, they retreat into the private world of their screens and stare at those instead of engaging in face-to-face exchange of thoughts and experiences. So we need to make sure that there is that opportunity for the sort of conversation that's the crucial carrier of family values.
Great. Well, we are going to include this interview in the Jesus-Centered Life Conference. And how about passing on the faith to the children through the family meals or conversations in the family meals? Does that help?
Yeah, absolutely. That should be part of it. For example, tonight, you know, it was mentioned that you can offer a prayer intention. You can say, you know, I would like your prayers for this math test that's coming up, or I got a big soccer game, or this kid at school I don't know how to deal with. I'd appreciate if everybody in the family would pray for that. So you can share prayer intentions and kind of a, you know, go around family circle. We would come home from Sunday Mass together and ask everybody to respond to the question, what was something from Mass that was a meaningful moment for you? Maybe it was the moment of the consecration. Maybe it was one of the readings. Maybe it was your after prayer, after communion prayer with Jesus. And what was the moment for you that was a meaningful moment from the Mass? And everybody would respond to that. So each person is invited. Sometimes we would say, all right, what are your goals for this Lent? What are you doing? Perhaps something new that you haven't done before. Or what are your goals for at the Advent season? Something that you're going to do to make Advent meaningful preparation for the coming of Jesus at Christmas time. How do you pray? When do you pray? What are your struggles in prayer? How has your prayer changed over time? All these things are topics for family conversation in the family meal. And it can be a morning meal. It doesn't have to be necessarily the family dinner hour. I have a friend in England, and I was there, for example, when he and his wife and their three teenage children gathered for the family breakfast, and they would start with a reading from scripture, and then they would ask, okay, what challenges are you facing today? And what graces do you feel that you need? And they would pray for each other's challenges in the day that was coming up. So there are many ways that this could also be a vehicle for strengthening our relationship with the Lord.
Great. Fantastic. Well, I think that's more than 10 minutes already, Tom. I can do a bit of editing to remove some, well, even the questions I'm asking you. For example, I'm just going to flash on screen the question, and then I'll put you in already answering the question. Great. Tom,
One final tip.
Go ahead.
Final tip, if I could. In the beginning, sometimes this feels a little strange to children, to families that haven't done it before. And you can introduce it by saying, you know, this is something that another family we know has done, and they really have come to enjoy it. So we'd kind of like to try it here, and let's give it a chance. So you can soften the potential resistance by introducing it in that way.